Hi, this is Dr. Rajita. Welcome to Anatomy Channel. And today we shall learn about anterior abdominal wall. And to study in an easy way, I am going to split the anterior abdominal wall topic into three sessions. In first session, we are going to see its extent, skin, and superficial fascia, and along with its contents. And in second session, we are going to learn about the muscles of anterior abdominal wall. And in third session, we are going to see about rectus sheath, fascia transversalis, and clinical anatomy in relation to anterior abdominal wall. So let's begin with the extent of anterior abdominal wall. It extends, to say in a right way, it is actually anterolateral abdominal wall because it is present anterior as well as on the lateral side of the abdomen, and it is extending in the midline from the xiphoid process. Xiphoid process is the lower tip of the sternum and till the pubic symphysis down. Xiphoid process lies at the level of vertebral level, thoracic 9th vertebra. And pubic symphysis lies at the level of coccygeal vertebra. Superolaterally, the lower margins of the costal cartilages of 7th, 8th, 9th costal cartilages all will join to form superolateral boundary. And laterally, it extends till the mid-axillary line. And anteriorly, inferiorly, there is a ligament which connects from ASIS, anterior superior iliac spine, to pubic tubercle. The ligament is called as inguinal ligament. So, inguinal ligament separates anteriorly from anterior abdominal wall from the thigh. And laterally, it is formed by the iliac crest of the hip bone. So, this is about the extent. And the skin of the anterior abdominal wall, it is unique because it is stretchable, and there is no deep fascia beneath the superficial fascia in anterior abdominal wall. So that is the reason it allows the skin to stretch enormously. And during pregnancy and during obese people, we can see how far the skin can stretch. And in pregnant, because of overstretching of anterior abdominal wall, it results in a vertical white lines which are called as stretch marks, called as linea albicans. And even the abdomen can stretch in pathological conditions called like ascites, where there is a fluid collection in the peritoneal cavity. And in any tumors also, we can see the abdominal wall, how far it can stretch. So that is about the skin. Next we'll see about the umbilicus, because the umbilicus is the most important landmark present in the anterior abdominal wall. In healthy individuals, umbilicus is present between L3 and L4. That is intervertebral disc between L3 and L4, it is present in healthy individuals. In infants and individuals with pendulous abdomen, with obese individuals, it is little lower level. And umbilicus is considered as a watershed line in the abdomen because the venous drainage and lymphatic drainage is different above to the level of umbilicus, and below it is different. And the nerve supply around the umbilicus, it is from the spinal segment, thoracic T10 level. And umbilicus is the remnant of the root of the umbilical cord, and embryologically it has got very important. It is very important because it is the site where the four folds of embryonic plate will fuse, like two lateral folds, head fold and tail fold. All the four folds converge to the umbilicus. And embryologically, the other important thing is, it is the site where the three systems meet. That is the digestive system, vitelo-intestinal tract during development, and excretory system, that is urethrus, and cardiovascular system, that is blood vessels present within the umbilical cord. The umbilicus is a very important landmark which is seen in the anterior abdominal wall. And it is the remnant of root of umbilical cord, and it is the site for portocaval anastomosis, where tributaries of portal vein anastomose with the systemic veins. And in portal hypertension, if there is increased blood pressure in the portal veins, these anastomotic channels open up to form collateral circulation. And these dilated veins are seen radially from umbilicus called caput medullae. So coming to the superficial fascia, beneath the skin there is a superficial fascia. And till the level of the umbilicus, the superficial fascia is present in a single layer. And below the level of umbilicus, the superficial fascia is present in two layers. The outer layer is called as fascia of Camper, which is a fatty layer. And deeper layer is a membranous layer, which is called fascia of Scarpa. And fascia of Scarpa continues as Colles fascia in the perineum, where it has got attachments, and because of its attachments it doesn't allow the urine to excavate during the rupture of urethra into posteriorly extrarectal fossa, and also it prevents into the thigh, extravasation of urine into the thigh. So this is the anterior view of the abdomen showing the attachments of fascia of Scarpa. So fascia of Scarpa attaches to the, this is the pubic symphysis here, and laterally here is the pubic tubercle. So it attaches to the pubic tubercle. From pubic tubercle, around 8 cm in lateral line, which is called as Holden's line. And fascia of Scarpa also attaches to the anterior surface of the body of the pubis, where adductor longus gracilis gets origin, and this fascia of Scarpa also attaches to the deep fascia of these muscles, and further it attaches along the pubic arch and posterior limit of perineal membrane. It attaches to the along the posterior limits of perineal membrane. And this is about the attachments of fascia of Scarpa. And above to the level of umbilicus, both the fascia of Camper and Scarpa, they merge to form a single layer. And whatever we see the contents supplying the skin, like cutaneous nerves, cutaneous arteries, cutaneous veins, lymphatics, they are all present between these two layers. So let's see the contents within the fascia. So starting with the contents of superficial fascia, we'll see about the nerve supply, which I have drawn on one side. The nerves are thoracic nerves from lower 6 thoracic nerves. Lower 6 thoracic nerves, out of lower 6 thoracic, the upper 5 are the intercostal nerves, and last 6th thoracic nerve is the subcostal nerve. And below that, the last lumbar nerve. The lumbar nerve is iliohypogastric nerve, which is derived from L1. So that is about the nerve supply. And lateral side, they are also supplied by T10 and T11. So let's see about the blood supply. The blood supply, the arteries which are present are the superior epigastric artery, branches of the superior epigastric. Superior epigastric is in turn the branch of internal thoracic artery. And from down we can see here inferior epigastric artery supplying the anterior abdominal wall, and posterior intercostal arteries on the either side, and circumflex iliac artery. Superficial, there are two circumflex iliac arteries: superficial circumflex iliac artery and deep circumflex iliac arteries, and superficial epigastric arteries. All these are the branches of femoral artery, which supply the lower part of the abdomen below the umbilicus. So this is about the arterial supply. Veins also are of same names, that is a superior epigastric vein, inferior epigastric vein, then posterior intercostal veins, circumflex iliac veins, and superficial epigastric veins. So these iliac veins drain into the saphenous veins, and superiorly they drain into internal thoracic veins. And let's see about the lymphatic drainage. And we know the umbilicus is a watershed line. So above to the level of umbilicus, the lymphatic drainage drains into axillary lymph nodes, and below to the level of umbilicus, they drain into inguinal lymph nodes. So this is about the lymphatic drainage of anterior abdominal wall. So let's see about the muscles in the next session. Thank you. I hope you like my session. Please like, share, subscribe.